less than during the same month a year ago, and home prices just keep on rising. Meantime, applications for new mortgages fell almost 3% last week. That's because loan rates rose to their highest level so far this year. On Wall Street, stocks are mixed, but mostly lower on worries about whether the GOP health care bill will pass tomorrow and because of slumping shares of energy and bank companies. Right now, the Dow is down 39 points. The Nasdaq, though, up 12. Shares of Sears down 14% today after reporting in a regulatory filing that it's worried about its ability to remain open. Sears isn't the only retailer in real trouble today. Payless Shoes, considering filing for bankruptcy next week, and it may close 500 stores. Tom Busby, CNBC.
This just in, Wendy's is adding the quarter pound double stack as an option in the 4 for $4 for a limited time. With so much beef, that's a deal so good it should not exist. In related news, because their wings are too small for their bodies, bumblebees should not be able to fly. Here to comment, Bees.
Wait, we're not supposed to fly?
Kinda like how a quarter pound of beef should not be in the 4 for $4.
Yet it is. That's over a quarter pound of fresh beef with 4 nuggets, fries, and a Coke, all for just $4. Any other bee puns?
No, we're good, honey.
At participating Wendy's for a limited time, meal includes 4-piece nuggets, small fries, and drink. Fresh beef available in the contiguous U.S., Alaska, and Canada. Not valid in Alaska and Hawaii.
The scraping. The scrubbing. Is this what changing your cat's litter box sounds like? Then slide on over to new Arm & Hammer Slide. The revolutionary clumping litter that doesn't stick to the litter box. It just slides right out. Without scraping or scrubbing. And delivers a 7-day odor-free home guaranteed. So stop scraping. And start sliding. With Arm & Hammer Slide Cat Litter.
NBC News Radio, I'm Lisa Carter. British investigators now say 4 people are dead in the attack at Parliament. Mark Rowley with London Metro Police saying some 20 people are hurt. The White House speaking out on the apparent terror attack.
We obviously condemn today's attack in Westminster, which the United Kingdom is treating as an act of terrorism.
Press Secretary Sean Spicer. London police say a possible terrorist mowed down pedestrians on Westminster Bridge before crashing his vehicle. The attacker then stabbed a police officer at the Parliament building and was later shot and wounded. House Republicans moving ahead with efforts to repeal and replace Obamacare. The House Rules Committee meeting today to set the rules for tomorrow's floor debate on the GOP plan. The committee will also make changes to the Republican health care bill, designed to draw more support from conservatives and moderates alike. New version will speed up the GOP's repeal of the tax hikes that Obamacare imposed on the wealthy. Lisa Carter, NBC News Radio.
Did you know that 80 to 85% of children's brains are developed by the time they are 3 years old? The San Bernardino City Unified School District is sponsoring free parenting education classes for families of children ages 0 to 36 months. Classes include free childcare, a light meal, children's books to take home, and weekly giveaways. Graduates earn a certificate of completion. For more information, please visit www.infanttoddlersuccess.org or call 909-347-7313.
Hi, this is Beth from Let's Go Shopping with Beth. If you love to shop like I do, looking for the best deals, everything from antiques to zoos, you're gonna hear about it on Let's Go Shopping with Beth. Each Wednesday, you'll enjoy a new and different show with our marvelous guests. They'll tell us about everything that's going on in the Inland Empire and beyond. Join us each Wednesday from 1 p.m. to 2 p.m. right here on KCAA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM. Ciao.
In AgNet West today, ag producers are placing a priority on farm bill funding for research. Stephanie Ho has more.
The specialty crop representatives came from different parts of the country, but they all shared at least one common interest.
I think research is probably the single biggest initiative that we should be focusing on.
That was James Field from Illinois-based Fry Farms, who testified before a House Agriculture Subcommittee about what he thinks should be a priority in the next farm bill. Another panelist was Larry Black, whose Peace River Packing Company's business in Florida has been hit by citrus greening, and he adds that isn't the only threat.
Some examples are citrus leprosus, CVC, et cetera, that are around the world. We know they're in our backyard, and we need to be ready with research. Research is the key.
According to the 2012 Ag Census, the total value of specialty crops reached nearly $60 billion, or one-fourth of the total value of U.S. crop production. This is Stephanie Ho reporting for the U.S. Department of Agriculture in Washington, D.C.
Timely nutrition is critical for successful yields. What if your crops could utilize nutrients faster, more thoroughly, and more efficiently? That's what happens when you add NutraSync brand micronutrients from Loveland Products. NutraSync is a unique foliar technology that stimulates plants' uptake of nutrients for maximum utilization, which can help you to improve crops' growth, quality, and yield potential. Ask your crop production services location about NutraSync brand micronutrients today.
When it comes to a healthy bottom line for your farming operation, nothing helps like healthy soil. Producers who use soil health management systems report lower input costs while maintaining or even improving their yields. Contact your local Natural Resources Conservation Service office today to find out more and unlock the secrets in your soil.
I'm Sabrina Hill for AgNetWest.com.
KCAA Loma Linda, your CNBC news station, where your business comes first.
Live from the headquarters of Ramsey Solutions, it's the Dave Ramsey Show, where debt is dumb, cash is king, and the paid-off home mortgage has taken the place of the BMW as the status symbol of choice. I'm Dave Ramsey, your host. This is your show. Thank you for joining us, America. We're glad you're here. You jump in and we'll talk. The phone number is 888-825-5225. That's 888-825-5225. Ann starts off this hour in Cleveland, Ohio. Hey, Ann, how are you?
I'm good. How are you, Dave?
Better than I deserve. How can I help?
Okay, I have a startup. I thought it up in 2013, and it was an idea that didn't exist in the market. It has a great niche business, and it has great expansion possibilities. So I was able to open up production channel through China to get it going. So we started doing conventions for my business through this year, and we've been able to do it debt free. So we're kind of just cash on the bill the whole time. We've been watching the competition, kind of pivoting on price points, and we'll know more about how our costs are coming out, how we do this season, probably by the end of May. I just want to ask you, in your history or from your life experience, is there a reasonable timeline you would give for a startup to either fly or shut it down or let it be in ongoing hobby status in hopes that it'll pop in the future?
No, I don't have a set thing. I use some principles to look at when we launch a product line or launch a new area of this business that would almost be considered a new business, that kind of a thing. And what we want to look for is, number one, it has to self-sustain or we run out of cash at some point and we don't want to carry it any further. You can only feed it until you're out of money, in other words. So that's one limiting factor. So the timeline is controlled by the burn rate if you're feeding it. You follow me?
Yeah, we're not right now.
So far, you're not facing that. Okay.
No, we're not facing that. And now that we've the feeding it really would be maintaining insurance.
Well, I mean, that's feeding it. It's not carrying its own
weight.
Okay.
Right. It's about $1,200 a year.
Yeah. And so if it, you know, at some point you're gonna it runs a course and you don't want to feed it anymore.
Right.
Or you can't. You run out of money to feed it. In your case, it's not a lot of money, so in terms of the amount you're feeding it, so it's not going to break you, in other words. But you don't go into debt to keep it open is my point. So that's the bottom line. That's your starting point, the cellar of, you know, the basement of timelines. And then from there, what I use is what Henry Cloud uses in the book Necessary Endings. You close a relationship down, which would include a business, when you've lost hope that it's going to change. And so we closed down one this year, a thing we had been offering here. But what happened was the space that it was in was a race to the bottom on pricing. And so prices were getting cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. Quality was getting cheaper and cheaper and cheaper in that space. The delivery was just horrendous. The competitors are just grotesque in terms of what they were producing. And yet that's what the marketplace was eating up. And so we didn't like the race to the bottom, number one. Number two, we looked at the size of the market, and it was a limited size. Even if we became the biggest dog on the porch, we weren't going to be a big dog because it's not a big space. And then number three, in this particular case, we saw just horrendous Obama overregulation.
Yeah.
And they were just hammering the space with regulations. And so, you know, a race to the bottom, overregulation, and, you know, we caused us some business-wise, we lost our business hope. The size of the market was small to start with. So we just said, it's not worth it. It's not worth it to hang on. And we were making a profit, but it just, there was no fun in the future that we could see because of those things. And so that's what I mean by losing your business hope. There's no financial fun in the future. And so you said competitors have entered the market. They're affecting price in your case. That's what made me think of that.
See, we're the competitor, and we've entered that market. They've been in the market for a while, but our one product is unique to the market, and we've adapted and added on product that matches the competitor. So we're pivoting on the price point and kind of really taking a really good, like, is it what's checking, what's not checking, and seeing how profitable we can be.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so the bottom line is, how much profit did you make last year?
We're still repaying startup costs. So
you didn't make a profit?
No.
How much profit will you make this year?
Probably we'll make about like
$15,000.
Yeah.
Okay. And if this goes bananas and it really hit the curve and it hockey sticked, the chart hockey sticked, it shot straight up, what would be your wildest dreams on profit?
Oh, my God. That would be a lot. Because right now it's regarding a sorority, one sorority, and there's 30 national sororities.
It could be millions? Millions?
A million. Probably over a million. You know, let's say 300,000. Just say that right now.
Okay. All right. Well, then you need to see some track that's heading in that direction. If you're at 15 and the next year you're at 16 and the next year it's 17, I'm starting to lose my business hope.
Okay.
If the market size profit wise is 300 to a million, I need to go from 15 to 50, and then I need to go from 50 to 100. I need to see some movement that I'm actually accomplishing brand penetration here, and that I'm starting to own enough of a segment of the market to make a dadgum living out of this thing.
Right. But
right now it's hobby.
Yep, that's right.
And so I need to see it moving away from that to continue to pour my efforts into it.
Okay.
And you know, I don't know, maybe we always talk about we have to find the keys to the lock and unlock the market, and you hadn't found the keys to the lock yet. You have a set of keys, but you hadn't unlocked it yet.
No, we haven't unlocked it yet, but I feel very hopeful about the product, and the niche is so unbelievable.
Yep.
You're
going to lose all of that zest eventually if you don't see it turn into the bottom line.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. So I don't know. Maybe two more years. I don't care. Nothing here is making me mad. Nothing here is delusional. You've obviously got a very good analytical mind the way you presented this. And you know, you're sharp. You've got some business acumen. So I think you're going to be fine. But if it were me, Dave Ramsey, I'm going to end up closing the thing, you know, within 24 to 36 months if I don't see it busting out and really reaching towards six figures in profit.
Okay.
I'm going to move on. I'm going to use opportunity cost on my time and on my brain, you know.
Right.
I'm going to move on to something that I can make a little money doing, because I think you've got the potential to make some money doing something. So maybe you broaden the product line. Maybe you continue to adapt it. Maybe it's a price point thing. Maybe you find a marketing distribution system you hadn't found before. I don't know what it is. But the way we're going to analyze it, where this one of our products here or one of our P&Ls here. Hold on. I'll have Kelly pick up. I'm going to give you a copy of the book Entree Leadership, which is our Super Bowl playbook on how we run this business. Number one New York Times best-selling book. Hold on, I'll have Kelly give you one. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. As a business owner, hiring the right people is one of the most important things you'll ever do. Finding people that understand your mission and align with your core values can sometimes be difficult. That's why you need to be able to explore as many candidates as possible. I recommend ZipRecruiter. It's the best way to find the perfect hire. With ZipRecruiter, you can post your job to 200-plus job sites, including social media networks like Facebook and Twitter, all with a single click. You can also find candidates in any city or industry nationwide. Just post once and watch your qualified candidates roll in to ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. Quickly screen the candidates, rate them, and hire the right person. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by Fortune 100 companies and thousands of small and medium-sized businesses. Post your jobs on ZipRecruiter for free at ZipRecruiter.com/Dave. ZipRecruiter.com/Dave.
Hey guys, Rachel Cruz here. If you haven't budgeted with Every Dollar yet, you have got to try it. I said goodbye to budgeting with pen and paper when I realized how easy it was to budget with Every Dollar. Even better, it's free. It takes less than 10 minutes to create your budget, and my favorite thing about Every Dollar is I can access my budget and track my spending on the go from my phone. Every Dollar is helping millions of people take control of their money. Create your free budget today at everydollar.com. That's everydollar.com.
Sarah can't pay her bills because she spent a ton of money on an education that's unemployable. Be smart and get an education in a field that's going to generate an income. Check out CareerStep. CareerStep offers training to quickly prepare you for a career in healthcare with options to work from home. They also help with job placement, and if you enroll today, you may qualify for a free laptop or up to $400 off your tuition. Visit careerstep.com/Dave for details.
Hey, Bonnie, your ride is looking sweet and that bumping sound.
Yeah, Kamish, thanks for your referral to Allen Ed's Auto Sound and their expert installations with custom sound systems.
That's right, Kamish. Allen Ed's has a wide variety of mobile electronics and accessories from car stereos to vehicle security, including complete interior and exterior upgrades, as well as a full line of restyling options for your car, truck, boat, or off-road vehicle. Allen Ed's serves the Inland Empire and San Diego and Los Angeles counties. You can also catch Allen Ed's Auto Sound at upcoming events. Extreme Auto Fest, Hot Import Nights, OC Block Party, The Dub Show, Low Rider Super Show, SEMA in Vegas, and also the LA Auto Show. Stop by the Allen Ed's Auto Sound booth and see our friend Alden Allen, the event coordinator and social media specialist.
Check out Allen Ed's Auto Sound website at www.al-eds.com or call 888-900-8800.
Allen Ed's Auto Sound. Big bump.
Inland Body and Paint is a family-owned and operated fleet collision and repair shop that's proud to live in and help our community. Bring your heavy-duty trucks and or equipment to their Fleet Collision and Paint Center in Fontana for expert collision repair services. With 35 years of experience, you're sure to receive quality workmanship at an excellent price from Inland Body and Paint Center. From fiberglass repairs to quality painting, they'll take care of your truck and equipment from top to bottom in their new 64-foot spray booth. By the way, Inland Body and Paint of Fontana repaired and repainted the KCAA truck, and they can do the same job for your car, truck, or heavy-duty equipment. Inland Body and Paint, dedicated to the community and to your satisfaction. Call them today to learn what they can do for you. You can find Inland Body and Paint on Valencia in Fontana. Call them at 909-434-0466 or online at inlandbodyandpaint.com.
Listen to KCAA Loma Linda for less confrontation and more information.
Thank you for joining us, America. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. We're glad you're here. Karen is with us in San Antonio. Hi, Karen. Welcome to the Dave Ramsey Show.
Hi, Dave.
Hey, what's up?
Hey, I'm on baby step 7, and my financial advisor says that I can retire anytime. I'm 59, but I'm a little leery about doing that. I'm wondering what kind of factors I need to look at to make my decision to retire or not.
Is your investments making enough income for you to live off of like you want to live?
They're okay. They're not making tremendous amounts, but I mean, I've got about $650 in investments. The ranch is probably worth about $400.
Does the ranch make any money?
Barely breaks even.
Okay, that's not creating money to live on then. So $650 is creating how much money? $60,000 a year maybe.
Yeah, $60,000. Yeah, okay. I'd say about that. Yeah,
right.
And my husband and I are both retired Air Force, so we get our pensions.
Which is how much?
Mine's about $65,000 a year. His is going to be about $28,000 a year.
Okay, so I get $150,000 household income.
Yeah, well, right now I'm working as a nursing assist, so
well,
I'm
not counting
about
that. I'm saying if you quit.
Oh yeah, I'm thinking. Yeah,
I got 60. 000. I got 65 and 60 and 28 is what I got.
Yes, counting the investments. You're right.
Okay. And the business.
Yeah, the business, if I retire, I would sell it because it's a horse business and it's expensive.
That's the ranch.
Yeah, that's the ranch.
But it's breaking even. I was talking about your income.
Oh, well, I do anesthesia, so it's about $200,000 a year.
No, you're misunderstanding me. I'm sorry. When you retire, you would have the Air Force income, and
yep.
you would have $60,000 off of your investments. That's $125,000. Plus, you said your husband has $28,000 coming in from pension, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That puts you at $150,000, those three pieces do. Not counting
okay.
the horses, which break even, and not counting your nurse anesthetist, right?
Right.
And so can you make it on
$150,000? Yes, I could.
Okay. Then you can make it because you're making it off the Air Force retirement and off of the $650,000 you have invested. Now, if you sell the business, that gives you money, I guess?
Yes. Okay. I could probably sell it for about $100,000.
That would put another $100,000 in the investments, which would make another $10,000 or so, give or take. Okay?
Right.
And so, I mean, I'm just using round numbers. It might make 8, it might make 7, but whatever. It might make 12, so anywhere in there. Something like that. So rough numbers, yeah, you can. The thing is, you're 59, you make $200,000 a year, so you're an economic engine. You make a ton of money. Do you want to just completely quit, or do you want to slow down, or do you want to change the terms of your deal, or what?
I guess I honestly, I would like to just quit and retire and enjoy my family.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Well, 59 is early to do that and have absolutely nothing going on except enjoying your family, just from experience. If I were you, I would keep your certifications and so forth up.
Okay.
In case you decided you wanted to go back and pick up 20 hours a week or something, just for kicks.
Because you
have a very valuable career, and
okay.
if you're going to step away from it, do so in such a way that you can step back if you chose to.
Right, like maybe do a trial period of retirement, see if I like it or not.
Yeah, because the good news is, you know, you're in such demand, you can kind of set your own terms.
Yes.
In terms of when and how you work and so forth. And so I just don't want you to not be able to do that 5 years from now if you wake up bored out of your gourd.
Okay.
That's
I understand.
That's what I'm saying. And so, I think your financial advisor is giving you accurate information with what you've given me. If you can make it, so all I'm doing is, can you live on what you would have in that scenario? And those three numbers you gave me, give me $150,000, and I think you can probably do it on that.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Hey, good question. Thank you for joining us, and congratulations. You've done a great job building your wealth and getting your financial act together. There's a lot of you out there. Thank goodness. Chris is with us in Phoenix. Hi, Chris. How are you?
Hi. Thank you for taking my call.
Sure. What's up?
We have bought a home in 2011 on a short sale, so we got a really good price on it, and we've done some remodels. We just recently added a two-car garage with a room above it, and now my husband is sounding like he's going to have to transfer down to the Phoenix area. With his current company.
I'm sorry, down to where are you now?
I'm about 3.5 hours northeast of Phoenix.
Like Flagstaff area?
No, Pine Top.
Oh, okay. All right. Cool.
And my question is, we have all the remodel we've done on our house has been cash.
Mm-hmm.
Our only debt that we have is our mortgage, and it's a fairly small mortgage.
Mm-hmm.
And my question is, do we rent a house until this house sells so we'll have a substantial down payment for our next home?
Mm-hmm.
Or do we pull out 20% out of our investments, which we do have, and go ahead and buy?
Mm-hmm.
And then put the money from the house after it sells towards the principal.
Yeah. How old are you?
62.
Okay. So you can do that with only paying taxes on it.
Mm-hmm.
Of your tax rate, what's your household income?
We're at about $160,000.
Okay. So you're going to pay 40% on whatever you pull out. How much is in your investments?
We've got about $250,000.
Hmm. Not much. Okay. The more conservative thing would be just to rent until you get yours sold.
Okay.
That'd be the conservative thing to do. And I'm probably going to go that way. The thing that's bothering me, too, is I kind of think how expensive a home is this
that you currently live in? If we were to sell it now?
Yes, ma'am.
Probably around $260,000 to $275,000.
How unusual is that in that neighborhood?
It's about current. You know, pretty much. I'm a realtor, so mm-hmm. I pretty much know the market.
Okay. So, how quick? What's your average days on the market then, for a house like
well,
that?
Well, it's a seasonal area.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Summers are our best area. It's our best time, and mm-hmm. I don't think I'd have any problems in the neighborhood. We live in a real desirable area of Pine Top and the Country Club, and it's a real popular area. And we've done a ton of remodel on this house. So
I'm asking.
Really,
I mean, you think this is a 30-day market time?
I think it could be.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
If it's that, I might not rent. I might just get me a. You know, one of the corporate hotel rooms.
Okay.
The upscale corporate hotel rooms that you can stay in for a month. You've got you got the money to do that. That won't, you know, something nice that are mm-hmm. the, you know, with a kitchen and all, you know, the things I'm talking about, right?
Right.
And,
right.
You know, if you got a 30-day market time, now, if that thing freezes up or you head into next fall and you go, oh, this may take a year, then I might go rent something.
Right, right.
But you leave could leave your furniture in there and leave it staged.
Yeah, and we also have an RV, which we could use, but it's summertime in Phoenix.
Yeah, that might be a long summer.
Yeah. Yeah,
I'd turn into turn into a freaking oven.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And the other option would be my husband could stay with his sister, and I could actually stay in the house until it sells.
Yeah. Well, that could be a long 30 days, too. I don't know. I would just talk that through, but... The thing is, with a short market window like that, if it'll turn that fast, then you're mm-hmm. fine. And you know, you'll be able to accomplish all your goals. But, you know, if it doesn't turn by the end of summer, it sounds like you got a seasonal deal there that it may be next spring then, in which case I'd go rent me a house and take my furniture and hit to Phoenix. Good question. Thanks for joining us. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. Did you know the timeshare industry reported $8.6 billion in sales in 2015? $8.6 billion! And from 2014 to 2015 alone, the average timeshare maintenance fee went up 8.4%. Folks, that's real money you could have been using to pay down your debt, not add to it. If you're sick and tired of paying for a timeshare you just don't use or can't use anymore, get out. Call the only people I trust, Timeshare Exit Team, the industry leader who has exited thousands of my listeners safely, legitimately, and permanently, and they can do the same for you. Visit them at timeshareexitteam.com. Schedule your free consultation with your local expert in a real office, not a hotel room like the other guys. They'll walk you through all your options, and best of all, Timeshare Exit Team guarantees they will get you out or give you a full refund. timeshareexitteam.com.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, K292 FQ Riverside, and K293 CF Moreno Valley.
Team USA is on to its first ever championship game at the World Baseball Classic after edging Japan last night 2-1. They'll play Puerto Rico this evening at Dodger Stadium in Los Angeles. To the hoop in L.A., Clippers clobbered the Lakers 133-109. The Bucks beat the Blazers 93-90. Spurs tamed the T-Wolves 100-93. The Warriors won their fifth straight 112-87 over the Mavericks. Pelicans flew past the Grizzlies 95-82. Heat burned the Suns 112-97. Raptors turned back the Bulls 122-120. Late third quarter of that game, Robin Lopez and Serge Ibaka both ejected after they threw punches at each other, and Brooke Lopez delivered a knockout punch, an off-balance baseline jump shot at the buzzer that lifted the Nets over the Pistons 98-96. Hockey of note, Sidney Crosby, a circus goal, is league-leading 41st. Penguins ice the Sabres 3-1. Pittsburgh still 1 point back of Washington for the best record. Capitals doubled up the Flames 4-2. That's sports. Mark Ernay, NBC News Radio.
Did you know that more than 100,000 people a day are downloading game apps? Mobile apps have become a normal part of everyday lives. Now there's a new exciting sports app that lets you play along with your favorite professional sports team in real time. With this fantastic app, you can predict the next play and even outguess your favorite team members. The more predictions you get correct, the more points you receive. Points can be exchanged for cool prizes, like your favorite jerseys, hats, airline tickets, sports tickets, even a new car. You can play this amazing sports app by yourself, with your friends, or even with a large group of fans from all over the world. This incredible sports app is called FireFan, and it's available right now. Check it out. Sign up today at www.freefirefanapp.com.
From the KCAA Weather Center, I'm Tom Ladd. For this afternoon, showers likely, then showers, possibly a thunderstorm. Expect a high near 63. South wind at 5 to 10, becoming southwest. Gust as high as 20 expected. Showers likely tonight, possibly a thunderstorm. Mostly cloudy. Expect a low around 48. Chance of rain after 11 a.m. Thursday. Should be mostly cloudy, then becoming sunny with a high near 66. That's your weather forecast for this hour from KCAA, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM. 3-in-1, the trifecta of talk in Southern California.
In the mood for some great Chinese food? Well, Mr. Yu's Chinese food is where you need to be. Mr. Yu's Chinese food not only has a delicious dinner menu, they also offer delicious lunch specials, including their yummy fried rice and chow mein. But get this, it also includes any two items just for $5.85. Or you can get any one item for only $4.85. You should also try their big bowl special for just $4.10. The service is fast and friendly. Mr. Yu's Chinese food is located at 256 Carousel Mall in San Bernardino, California. To contact Mr. Yu's Chinese food, call 909-383-0195. Again, that's 909-383-0195. And yes, the Carousel Mall is still open.
That's right!
California's number one volume GM dealer, Mark Christopher Auto Center, says, "Keep your tax return. You earned it." So Mark Christopher is happy to bring you the Keep Your Money in Your Pocket sale. That's why they have incredible net costs on Chevy Cruze LS and Chevy Silverados, not to mention Malibus, Camaros, and yes, even the 2017 Corvette Stingray. You'll find Mark Christopher Auto Center right on the 10 freeway in Ontario. Or you can go to markchristopher.com. Mark Christopher, California's number one volume GM dealer. Family owned and doing things right since 1975. Mark Christopher, Vineyard exit of Interstate 10 in Ontario. Remember, it's the Mark Christopher Auto Center. Keep your money in your pocket sale.
KCAA Loma Linda, your CNBC news station for the Inland Empire.
Ramsey Solutions. Ted is with us. Hi, Ted. How are you?
Hey, doing great, Dave.
Welcome. Where are you from?
We're from Northeast Denver.
Northeast Denver. Okay, very cool. Sounds like almost out the airport direction, huh?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah, very cool. All right. And who's this with you?
It's my son, Parker, and my daughter, Talia.
Hi. And they're how old? Hi, Talia.
I'm 15, and my brother's 13.
All right. Very cool. And you guys are here to do a family debt-free scream.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely.
I love it. So how much have you paid off, Ted?
It's just shy of $116,000.
Way to go, man. How long did that take you?
Took 3 years and 7 months.
All right. Making what kind of income range during that time?
No, I started around $110,000 and finished up this last year around $200,000.
Good for you. What do you do for a living, sir?
I'm an IT technology consultant.
All right. Very good. Obviously doing well at it. Congratulations.
Thanks.
Very cool. So what happened 3 years and 7 months ago that lit you on fire like this?
I had a sit down with my accountant and realized that I owed quite a bit more money than I had thought. Pretty much just did a poor job managing the tax side of my business, and wasn't really ready for the outcome when the whole true up came down. And
so a lot of this was taxes.
It wasn't huge, but it was enough to scare the heck out of me.
Yeah, you don't want the KGB. I mean, the IRS after you. You know.
Exactly.
Yeah. So how much? What was the 116? What was it owed on?
A lot of different things. I've heard people say on the show quite a few times when they do their screams that they. They didn't find an item that they didn't owe on. I kind of feel the same way. There was a business loan. There was a car to pay off.
How much was the car?
Car was about $6,000. So
okay. Not too bad on that one.
Not too bad. Right. Yep. And then taxes was about $10,000. We had orthodontics, beautiful teeth.
Nice smiles. Nice smiles.
That was about $1,400. And I did the dreaded timeshare, which I regret today. That was about $5,400.
Mm-hmm.
And
so the vast majority was the business loan.
The vast majority, the biggest debt that I paid off just recently was the second mortgage on the home.
Oh, okay. All right.
And that was about $63,000.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay. I knew there was a big one in there because I was hearing all those little ones. Okay.
Yep.
Cool. Very cool. So you sit down with your accountant, the taxes are due, and you're like, okay, I'm going to have to be a grown-up and look at the – I can't just look at the earning side. I have to look at the outgo side, too. I got to clean this up. Then what did you do?
You know, I got scared. I had heard about FPU from my sister about 10 years ago. And so the seed had been planted. And my sister kind of laid the path for my siblings, my brothers and my other sisters. But I never really jumped on the bandwagon and went to church one day. And one of the guys that I've befriended over the last few years invited me to come do FPU, Financial Peace, with him and his wife.
Mm-hmm.
And so I finally decided, yeah, this sounds great. I've been meaning to do this for a while now. And
had this bad meeting at the accountant, so now's the time.
I did. I need to get my stuff together. And so I went and had an interesting reaction that I don't hear from a lot of people on the video channel. But after the third week at FPU, I was angry. I don't know if you get that reaction from many people. It's probably my crazy driven personality. I'm a high D, so in the DISC profile. But I just remember being angry for about 2 weeks because I was looking for that person to blame.
Ah.
And that person, of course, is the man in the mirror.
Yeah.
And, you know, as soon as I realized it was my fault, what I had led myself up to, you know, I finally started getting a little more serious.
You know, I went through that. I don't always hear a lot of people bring it up, like you said there. But when we went broke, that was what that's what happened to me. I woke up and I kind of went through the traditional stages of grief, you know, denial, and then anger is next, and acceptance, you know. And so that was kind of what I did. And that's when the acceptance part was when I looked in the mirror, like you said, and I said, okay, you're the problem, but you're also the solution. Get off your butt, son, and get this moving. And that's exactly what you did.
Yep.
Wow. Very cool. Very cool. Well, that's because it's a great emotion if it's challenged in a positive way or channeled in a positive way, yep. That is. So, very cool. So, what part did Talia and Parker play in this process?
Well, we have just been here this whole time. We live with him half the time and with mom half the time. And it was a real shock at first because we were kind of like, what is dad doing?
He's joined a cult.
What is happening? Why are we suddenly not going out to eat? Why are we suddenly... and he kind of explained to us, and this happened when I was about 12. So it took a little getting used to. And I think the hardest moment would have been last summer when I love Christian music, and my two of my absolute favorite artists, Carrie Job and Rend Collective, had this huge concert at Red Rocks. And I told him like a month in advance. And at this point in time, I knew how the budget system worked. I knew that we had to do this at the beginning of the month. So I told him a month in advance, and I told him, I really want to go to this, and we need to go to this. And I just remember him saying, nope, we got to pay off the debt. And I was kind of like, oh.
Ah, there it is.
Why?
There's the bottom.
Yeah.
So now that you've seen him go through all of this, you're obviously a bright, articulate young lady.
Thank you.
What have you seen change in your dad?
Just this drive in him, it's beautiful to watch this transformation that has happened, and I'm super duper proud of him for just sticking to this and going through this, and it's just been wonderful to see.
Wow. I can't get much better than hearing your kids say that. Life's pretty good, Ted.
Thanks.
Well done, sir. Well done. That's awesome. Very cool. So, Ted, when people hear that a single dad has paid off $116,000 in debt, and they say, how did you do that? What do you tell them the secrets to getting out of debt are?
You know, I think a lot of it is, it has to do with the system that you and your team's created. I think, you know, the video channel, everybody that's in here right now, I'm sure has taken a look at the video channel. I'm sure everyone's heard you on the radio. I mean, if you're single, for sure, and I say this to all the single guys and gals that are, you know, going through this plan today, you just have to tie into the system. You have to tie into the radio. Listen to the radio. Just pick a couple days that you can get, half an hour in. And just be devout about listening to it every single day if you can.
Becomes your support system? Is that what you're saying?
Totally.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Yep. Well, I know the debt-free screams are highly viewed on YouTube. People watch them over and over and over again for constant updates. And the subscribers get them emailed to them. It makes it real easy to stay caught up on them and that kind of thing. And that's the only explanation for that, is it consistently lifts you up. It's a form of community. It really is that does that. So that's cool. That's cool. So what did you do tactically that caused you to be able to get out of debt? What things do you blame that on that you did?
You know, the journey has been, you know, obviously 3 years and 7 months. It seems like a lot longer. But, you know, it started, Dave, it definitely started as a spiritual journey. I think after the divorce, I ended up sort of plugging back into to my relationship with Christ and going back to church on a regular basis and really starting to incorporate that in with my kids as well. That was really important to me.
It's obviously paying huge dividends. Well, congratulations, you guys. Very, very well done. All right, Ted, Talia, Parker from Denver, Colorado. $116,000 paid off. 3 years and 7 months, making 110 up to 200. Count it down. Let's hear a debt-free scream.
Three, two, one.
We're debt-free! Yeah! That's how it's done right there. And that can be you. And you can join the community.
dial into your local radio station. Subscribe to the podcast 3 hours every day on iTunes, one of the top podcasts in America. Subscribe to the YouTube channel. Millions of views on the YouTube channel. And it's the Dave Ramsey Show. It has its own channel. You subscribe, it sends you an automatic email when we post a particular email or particular YouTube. What will your family do if you die? Did I get your attention? Well, good. If you're a father, mother, husband, or wife, it's your responsibility to have life insurance. No matter where you are in the baby steps, you have to deal with this right now. How will your family pay the mortgage, put food on the table, or pay for education? How will they deal with retirement and stay the course for getting out of debt and accomplishing something with their lives? This is what life insurance is all about. I knew when I started this show, it was something my listeners had to have, so I went out and found a company I could trust to offer the plans I believe in. That's why I've been talking about Zander Insurance for almost 20 years now. If you haven't dealt with this, please go to ZanderInsurance.com or call 800-356-4282 and let them help. This is a priority. It's not expensive, it's not complicated, and you need to do it today. That's ZanderInsurance.com or call 800-356-4282.
Hey guys and girls, this is the Commish with KCAA Radio. And if you're feeling blue with the flu, then you need to think Empire Clinical Research. Empire Clinical Research is currently enrolling people sick with the flu for an investigational flu study that can speed up recovery. Qualified participants may be compensated for time and travel. So think Empire Clinical Research and call 909-981-5321. Again, that number is 909-981-5321. And let them know that you heard it with the Commish.
Stardate March 22nd. The next big space telescope, James Webb, is being prepared for launch next year. And the one after that, which will look like a twin of the venerable Hubble telescope, is being developed. Yet even these instruments will leave many questions unanswered. So NASA is already planning the next generation of space telescopes. They'll be bigger than anything launched before and provide capabilities far beyond Hubble or Webb. A year ago, NASA picked four teams to outline concepts for the next big space telescope. They'll keep at it for two more years. After that, the National Academy of Sciences will review the ideas and recommend which one to develop. One telescope would be like a supersized version of Hubble. It would use a segmented mirror that could be as tall as a five-story building to look at a wide range of wavelengths. That would allow it to detect signs of life on planets in other star systems and watch the evolution of galaxies and black holes. Another concept would also provide details on other planets. It could photograph planets in Earth-like orbits and monitor their atmospheres for signs of life. The other ideas would look only at wavelengths that are invisible to the human eye. That would allow them to study the earliest galaxies or the disks of superhot gas around black holes. All of this will take time, though. Whichever concept NASA eventually picks, the telescope won't launch until at least the 2030s. And you can find much more about space telescopes in Stardate magazine. Subscription information at stardate.org. For the McDonald Observatory, I'm Sandy Wood.
You're listening to KCAA, your good neighbor along the way.
Thank you for joining us, America. Open phones this hour at 888-825-5225. You jump in. We'll talk. Jeff is with us in Salt Lake City. Hi, Jeff. How are you?
Good. Thank you.
Good. How can I help?
We were in debt and living a pretty good life about 3 years ago, and we were in our late 20s then. But we found out that we're not going to be able to have children without the help of, like, fertility treatment and things like that. So we tackled our debt, and we did really well. We've done really well. We got rid of a lot of that debt, but now, and we just refinanced our house to a 15-year, $181,000 of it to a 2.75 interest rate. And okay. So we're really comfortable with that, and that's excellent. Our only debt we have left.
Good.
But now we have this big question of how do we, you know, how are we going to pay for these fertility treatments, and is this something that we should, because, and the, I'm sure you can imagine, you've heard before, there's a little bit of anxiety that happens when you're in your 30s and you still want to have children, you haven't had one yet, and so we want to do this now. But we also, of course, have sort of learned our lesson not to get into debt or to borrow money. I don't even know if you can borrow money to pay for things like fertility treatments and things like that.
So you save up and pay for it? What would be wrong with that?
Are we going to run out of time?
How come? What's your household income?
We're both school teachers, and so our combined income is about $80,000 a year.
Okay. And a fertility treatment's typically $8,000 to $12,000. You can't do that making 80?
No, we can do it. I guess I have a lot of other anxieties of this idea of, okay, so we pay that up front, and then, you know, I guess I kept expecting this, you know, the stork would just come and bring this child, and I wouldn't have to think about all these other things.
Mm-hmm.
But just that idea of, well, so then the child comes, and then, well, then our income is cut down by half. Mm-hmm. When I chooses to stay home with that child.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, I guess I just have a lot of anxiety about this. And I mean, I don't know, you're
playing it out. Can you pay your house payment on, can you pay the house payment on $40,000?
Yeah, right now it's $1,390, but we decided to pay $1,500 a month to try and pay it off in, you know, 12 years instead of 15.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can you pay $1,390 on $40,000 income? That's going to be tough.
Yeah.
Okay. So regardless of where the baby comes from, adoption, stork, God sends a baby, fertility, if she decides to stay home, you're not living in that house. That's not anxiety. Okay. That's math.
Mm-hmm.
Because you now have a house payment that's going to be about 40% of your take-home pay.
Right.
So, you know, she may be a working mom.
Mm-hmm.
Or we don't live in that house. Either one's fine. I don't. I mean, you can make that choice. I don't care. But that's mm-hmm. an independent discussion of how do we pay for fertility treatments. Fertility treatments you can pay for making $80,000. You save up the money and pay for it this year. I mean, and you
absolutely. Yeah.
So that's not a. I mean, you know, and you may have to space out. You know what when you do what. With those treatments based on the ability to save the cash. I mean, you may take one run and then you may have to stop and save money and do another run and, you know, however you guys choose to go at this. Same thing with adoption, for that matter, as a possibility.
Yeah.
But I think the bigger strain on this situation is, mathematically, is to stay in that house with her not working outside the home. Now, maybe she can bring in some income doing some tutoring on the side and make up enough to be able to stay in the house. But you don't want a house payment at 40% of your take-home pay. That's not going to be healthy for you. And you're between 35 and 40 right in there. That's if she quits and comes home. 80s you're gross, right?
Yes.
And she makes 40 and you make 40, right?
Correct.
Okay, yeah. So that's where we are. So you're going to be you're going to struggle if she comes home in that house unless she creates an income while she's home, which she could easily do. I mean, tutoring, you can make a ton of money tutoring and still be there for the kid. So mm-hmm. it's a great stay-at-home option for a teacher is to open a tutoring service. And that, you know, they come to your house with your kid there asleep in the night, you know, taking a nap, and they get tutored in the afternoon for math or whatever it is. And you can make a ton doing that. It takes a little while to build the business up, but that's something that's going to have to happen if you do that. Now, as far as paying for the treatments, you see how making 80, you can save 12, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's
the next step. It's the,
yeah.
I don't know. I guess I always had that thought in my head of, well, you have a child and then you just figure it out. And no. Now I'm like in this beforehand idea of like, okay, I need to, what am I going to do here?
Yeah, you have to have a plan. And we just kind of laid out a loose one just now, you and I talking it through. You're either going to sell the house or she's going to create an income or she's not going to stay home. Those are your three options mathematically when the baby comes. So let's just decide which one that is. We're going to sell the house if she's and move to a cheaper house when the baby comes so that we can afford for her to stay home. She's not going to stay home. She's going to continue to teach. Or she's going to create some tutor income from home. That's my favorite option, is that third one, personally. But you can do whatever you want to do. My wife grew up, her mom was a teacher. She was a junior high science teacher, and Sharon turned out fine. I mean, she didn't die from her mother teaching during the day. And so worked out okay. My mom was a working mom when I was growing up, so we turned out fine. It's not the end of the world. Our kids were blessed then that Sharon stayed home with them full time. And that's wonderful, too. So not mad at you either way, whichever way you do. But like you said, what you have to do is the stress comes from being a grown-up and realizing with no plan, there's always a disaster. So we have to have a plan. And that way we don't get ourselves into a mess. Corey is with us in Nashville. Hi, Corey. Welcome to the Dave Ramsey Show.
Hey, thanks for taking my call, Dave.
Sure, man. What's up?
So I actually, my wife and I are actually taking your class, the Financial Peace University. We're actually in week four now. I wish I actually knew about your class sooner, but, I actually carry on the debt in our family. And the one thing that we're going through right now is actually going through a collections agency. I actually have a lawsuit this Thursday with a creditor, and I've never been sued by anybody before. And so kind of a little anxiety about it. And so I don't know whether to, before court, if I need to try to make a settlement with them. I got a call the day I got a summons and called them and tried to make a settlement. The debt was actually $2,300. And they asked for a settlement. They said 2040. And then by the end of the call, I made sure that we agreed upon 2040, and they pretended that they never said anything. So... That's why I was wanting to go to court and see.
So who did you call when you got summoned? The attorney?
Yeah, the attorney for the debt.
And the attorney was playing games?
Yeah.
That's unusual. Okay. So they're basically offering you no settlement.
Basically.
At this moment. Okay.
Yeah. So I don't know if that should be an option.
Do you have any money? You have the $2,000?
I do not.
Where are you going to get it?
I guess pretty much just try to save for it.
I'm sorry. If you thought you had a deal for 2040, what were you going to do?
I don't know.
Okay. Well, you can't make a promise to an attorney in the middle of a lawsuit and then not keep your promise, dude. So you better have your money lined up. Okay. So you got to figure out where the money's coming from. Do you have any money at all?
Yes.
How much?
Got $500.
Okay. That's all you could offer then, because that's all you've got, unless you get paid by between now and then. When's the court date?
This Thursday.
Okay. Well, the bottom line is the court date is a slam dunk. You owe the money. You haven't paid the money. You will lose the lawsuit. It's not the end of the world. You're just getting ready to have a judgment lien placed against you for that amount, and then you can settle the judgment lien, which it sounds like that's what you're going to do. I would just let it go ahead and go to judgment. If you want to go down there and watch it, you can, but it's not the end of the world. It's like a traffic ticket. It's just going to go to judgment, and they take a lien against you. If you own a home, it's a lien against your home. They're not going to do anything with any of it for a while, and you can continue to save and then negotiate a settlement on that judgment. And that's what I would do in this case.
Hey, guys, it's Blake Thompson, Senior Executive Producer of The Dave Ramsey Show. This hour, the show is over, but you can also watch the show in HD video 24/7 on our free mobile app on our website at DaveRamsey.com. It's all free. We're everywhere to serve you.
Certified business coach and Ramsey personality, Christy Wright,
is my trusted voice for women in small business. She travels the country coaching women on how to start and grow their business. From the earliest stages of finding their ideas all the way through achieving more success than they ever imagined. In her new book, Business Boutique, A Woman's Guide for Making Money Doing What She Loves, you'll learn how to overcome your fears, market your business, and sell without feeling pushy. And by the end of the book, you'll have a customized plan to run your business. Pre-order Business Boutique today, and you'll get over $60 in digital bonus items for free, including the ebook and the audiobook, plus a marketing basics PDF and a video, which you will receive instantly. Are you ready to turn your passions into money? Well, go to DaveRamsey.com and pre-order today. This deal will not last, so call us at 888-22-PEACE or DaveRamsey.com, 888-227-3223.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM.
Financial.
Good afternoon. I'm Chuck Kamlick, CNBC. Stocks treading water today, mostly flat. The Dow down 4, the NASDAQ up 26, the S&P 5 higher. Investors keeping their powder dry, though, until after tomorrow's health care vote. Sears dropped a bombshell on Wall Street, warning it may not be able to survive. That sent its stock plunging and scared the pants off mall owners everywhere. Nike stock dropped 6% after it warned that Adidas and Under Armour might steal some future business. AT&T's pulling its ads might show up next to controversial videos on YouTube. AT&T will still allow its ads to show up on Google search. Starbucks will hire 240,000 workers worldwide by 2021. That includes 15,000 veterans in this country. And Starbucks customers who own a Ford that's equipped with Amazon's Alexa will now be able to order and pay for their coffee while they're driving. Chuck Kamlick, CNBC.
The scraping. The scrubbing. Is this what changing your cat's litter box sounds like? Then slide on over to new Arm & Hammer Slide. The revolutionary clumping litter that doesn't stick to the litter box. It just slides right out, without scraping or scrubbing, and delivers a 7-day odor-free home guaranteed. So stop scraping and start sliding with Arm & Hammer Slide Cat Litter.
Get a large two-topping pizza at Pizza for just $7.99 when you order online. The only $7.99 deal you can have delivered. It's hands down, feet up, stay in and chill out, the best pizza delivery deal. And to get it, just head to pizzahut.com. It's a full-on, shoes-off, easy-breezy, hard-to-beat win for your wallet. $7.99 large two-topping pizzas, because no one out pizzas the Hut. Ask or click for this limited-time offer. Additional charge for extra cheese, stuffed crust, and additional toppings. Product availability, prices, participation, delivery areas and charges, and minimum purchase required for delivery may vary. Delivery charge is not a driver tip.
NBC News Radio, I'm Lisa Carter. The death toll from today's terror attack in London stands at 4 after a man driving a car struck several people on Westminster Bridge near Parliament. Mark Rowley with London Metro Police saying a police officer and the attacker are among the deceased. Rowley describes what happened after the suspect mowed down people on the bridge.
The car then crashed near to Parliament, and at least one man, armed with the knife, continued the attack and tried to enter Parliament.
Police say an officer protecting Parliament was stabbed by the attacker, who was shot by police. Some 20 people hurt in the attack. Meanwhile, security being beefed up at British sites in New York City after today's attack in London.
Here at the British Consulate, the NYPD's counterterrorism unit is now on the scene. Officers with their long guns and canines at the ready. They're also keeping an eye on the UN. This is the NYPD's standard response whenever there's a major terror attack around the world, but so far, nothing to indicate New York is a target. And no comment from the British Consulate on this tragedy in their homeland.
Ethan Harp reporting from New York. The chairman of the House Intelligence Committee says he has received evidence that members of the Trump transition team were under surveillance after November's election. After briefing President Trump at the White House, California Republican Devin Nunes said there was nothing about Russia in the communications. He told reporters that the surveillance appeared to be legal, incidental collections that were unrelated to Russia. Nunes also said some of it appears to be inappropriate. Pepsi pulling 2-liter bottles and soda six packs from store shelves in Philadelphia because of the city's new beverage tax. The tax is levied by the ounce, and Pepsi says it wants to offer sizes working families can better afford. Critical vote by the NFL owners on the proposed relocation of the Oakland Raiders to Las Vegas could come as early as next week. There are numerous reports that the potential move is on the owners' agenda at the league meetings that start Sunday in Phoenix. You're listening to the latest from NBC News Radio.
Inland Body and Paint is a family-owned and operated fleet collision and repair shop that's proud to live in and help our community. Bring your heavy-duty trucks and or equipment to their fleet collision and paint center in Fontana for expert collision repair services. With 35 years of experience, you're sure to receive quality workmanship at an excellent price from Inland Body and Paint Center. From fiberglass repairs to quality painting, they'll take care of your truck and equipment from top to bottom in their new 64-foot spray booth. By the way, Inland Body and Paint of Fontana repaired and repainted the KCAA truck, and they can do the same job for your car, truck, or heavy-duty equipment. Inland Body and Paint, dedicated to the community and to your satisfaction. Call them today to learn what they can do for you. You can find Inland Body and Paint on Valencia in Fontana. Call them at 909-434-0466 or online at inlandbodyandpaint.com.
You're listening to KCAA, your good neighbor along the way.
Hello and welcome to Let's Go Shopping with Bev. This show brought to you by Starflight Entertainment. Music by Dr. Bombay and the Blue Machine Band. Song title, Living in Paradise. Now here's Bev.
Well, welcome to the show, everybody, and happy Wednesday to you. And I say this every week, but I'm going to say it again. If you've seen the post on Facebook and Twitter and that plane that we have flying around with a flag with everybody's name on it, if you happen to see it, you know who's on the air. If you did not see it, we will still tell you who's on the air. First of all, let's have a big hand to Brandon, our board up. Hi, Brandon.
Good afternoon.
And you doing okay today?
Yeah, I am. How are you?
We're doing good. And before I introduce our first two guests, that little piece of music that we had for these two characters, could you play a little bit of that, please?
You mean this one?
If I could talk to the animals, just imagine it, chatting to a chimp in chimpanzee. Imagine talking to a tiger, chatting to a cheetah. What a neat achievement it would be. If we could talk to the animals, learn their languages, maybe take an animal degree. I'd study elephant and eagle, buffalo and beagle, alligator.
Thank you, Brandon. We love that song. And yes, the title of this particular program, If I Could Talk to the Animals, and we figured that song was just perfect. And sitting next to me, we have Miss Carmen, and next to her is Dr. Ken, and they are from the Calamasa Veterinary Clinic in Calamasa, on Calamasa Boulevard. I mean, it could not get any easier to find this place. And how I happened to find these two fantastic people is my grandson, Michael Anthony, and his girlfriend, Gigi, found a baby little kitten on Halloween. And they immediately picked him up, put him in a blanket. They brought him on home. He looked like he was maybe an ounce of that. I mean, he was really in bad shape. So we gave him a little bit of milk and all this other. And then the next day, that's when we found you, yes. The Calamasa Veterinarian Clinic. And we brought, I called him Rocky, Mr. Kitty. The poor thing has three names, but he answers to all three. Especially when you say, are you hungry? He answers immediately. And the care that you took on that little kitty and got him to where he was supposed to be was absolutely marvelous. And I want to thank you so much. You know, and I'm thinking, how many more little kitties or doggies or orangutans are out there where nobody finds them? You know, I feel sorry for them. And so, Carmen, I'm going to turn the mic over to you. Okay. And would you please tell us the beginning of your story?
Oh, great. Well, thanks for having me.
You're welcome.
And that was a really nice introduction with the song. I enjoyed that.
Thank you. I'm going to be singing that song all day now.
So, my name's Carmen. I'm the administrator at Cala Mesa Veterinary Clinic in Cala Mesa. And I've just joined this group January 2017. So I've just been here for the last few months. But I've been an administrator for 25 years. And so I'm really excited to join a group of highly experienced veterinarians. What my understanding is, this place has been here for a long time, and I'll give you some more information on that. And as an administrator, I'm the one that's behind the scenes, but I do find little joys that keep me going and keep my spirits up, like when I come in first thing in the morning and I look at the schedule and I get to see fun names like Rocky.
Yay!
Lily. Little Boo Boo,
Lollipop. Kickaroni.
Interesting names. I say, okay, this is how my day is starting. I get to enjoy seeing all these various names. And as I'm working, I like to go back and take a look at what we're doing, who we're treating, and saying hello. And it's a very humbling experience. There are fur babies, and they're getting care, and some are not very well, and some are well, and having surgery. And so we'll just go pet and say hello. And they enjoy that. I know many times I'll come and I'll say, hi, how are you doing? And then the pet in the next kennel will say, hey, what about me? Say hi to me too. So these things are fulfillments to keep me going, as I'm working on different things, whether it be policies, equipment, whatever it may be. That's where I find my joy. Cala Mesa was started in the fall of 1993. As a brand new pet clinic in the Crown Village Center. And it was moved across the street to the current location that it is at now a few years later, and has remained there at the 980 Cala Mesa Boulevard. So the owner of the Cala Mesa Veterinary Clinic is Dr. Michael Andrews, and he graduated from Purdue University in West Lafayette, Indiana, in 1983, and has been in practice ever since.
Whoa.
Yeah. Our Cala Mesa Clinic offers a relationship with every pet owner to keep every pet family member healthy. So our veterinary clinic offers various services, and our vets and our technicians are skilled at treating various pet health issues. We offer the convenience of weekends and evening hours, drop-offs and pickups. And so we provide wellness checks, vaccines, nutrition, general surgery, dental care, emergency care, treatment services, and breed information. As a lot of people will say, I got this pet and I don't know what it is. It's mixed. Can you figure this out for me? So we offer various services. We have three highly experienced veterinarians. And I have to share with you, for me, being in the field, this is probably something I feel makes me feel very proud, but gives me a lot of comfort that I don't need to worry about anything from a medical standpoint, because we have exceptionally experienced doctors. It's very rewarding to know that they're giving top-notch care, and you can feel really comfortable about that. So one of our doctors is Dr. Elaine No. She graduated in 1993 from the University of California, Davis. She's been a veterinarian at the Cala Mesa Veterinary Clinic since 1998.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That's a long time.
Yeah. So she's part of that place. She's family. It's part of her whole being. She enjoys meeting pets and their people and helping them to keep their animals healthy. She does have a special interest in the feline medicine, so working with cats, and although she works with all pets. She also enjoys working with the geriatric medicine. So a lot of our senior pets, as pets get older, they require really close care. And she currently has a cat of her own. So that's Dr. No. Dr. Price is the son of a longtime Los Angeles area veterinarian, and he graduated from UC Davis Veterinary School. He's been practicing small animal medicine in Cali Mesa and Redlands area for almost 30 years. And Dr. Price grew up in Southern California, and his wife went to Redlands High School, and his three kids graduated from Yucaipa High. Mm-hmm. And he says it's great to be part of the local community. And I see the same people at the store, at the restaurants, at church, or in the neighborhood as I do at the clinic, making the profession very personal for me. That's basically what he had said to me. As for the comment on pet health care, he says, as our pets are living longer and longer, many issues that weren't a part of regular care in the past are becoming very important now, including dental care, which is a special interest of his.
Mm-hmm. Now, I want to break in on this. Mm-hmm. When you're saying how long the animals are living longer,
yeah,
just like people, we're living longer because we're eating better, we're getting more exercise, and, you know, all that other good stuff, right? Now, with the animals, with a lot of people, you know, we're going gluten-free, we're getting rid of all the fats and grease and all the crap that we used to eat. Yes, I can say that on air just one time, so I did. Now, with the animals, when they're redoing, because it seems like every time you go to the market, there's a new brand of food out for your kitty or your dog or your fish or your bird, your orangutan, what, you know, whatever you got. Is that almost pretty much what we're eating? Is that why there's living longer, or what is it?
That would be a good question for Dr. McMillan.
Yes, Dr. Ken, could you answer that, please?
Well, pets are living longer these days for a lot of reasons, and among those being nutrition. You know, some of the things that you go into, if you're going to like PetSmart, Petco, or, you know, any of these stores like that, are, to be quite honest about it, marketing, advertising, that type of thing. Probably one of the biggest things that we get into recently is everybody's talking about the grain-free diets, and grain-free, you know, for the average dog, really does not make a lot of difference as far as that type of thing goes. Where it would make a difference is if you had a pet that had something like a food allergy or something of that lines at this time. You know, but for the average pet, I mean, you know, your traditional diets, you know, with the corn or whatever, are actually okay. And in some ways, you know, you know, some of the companies like you to advertise out there that their products are more high in beef or high in protein, that type of thing. Well, you got to keep in mind that everybody is an individual at that point. And the long-term studies on proteins and things of that nature, they've actually proven things like high-protein diets can actually exacerbate kidney disease. So in that particular situation, that would not be appropriate. You know, most of the grain-free diets, they're basing their information on celiac disease in people, and pets don't really get celiac disease. So I think, you know, the rule of thumb is that, you know, as long as people are buying good quality nutrition and you do get what you pay for, you know, you have to look at the individual patient. And there is, you know, unlike what most dog food companies would like you to believe, that their product is the best product for every pet around. I mean, we're individuals, they're individuals, and you have to do what works for each and every pet. And, you know, I'd say that's just my best advice, is find what works and also what works for your budget, too.
And then the other thing I wanted to ask you, there are some people that I know, and this drives me bloody bonkers. They feed them people food.
Oh, no.
And they feed them ice cream and all of this. That is a big no-no, isn't it?
That's a huge no-no. And the reason behind that is that their internal systems are not really designed to handle those types of things. You know, pets are basically omnivores, you know, but they also need kind of a controlled, bland-type diet. And, you know, if they get the ice cream, they get the fats from the steak, you know, they get the pizza, you know, the pasta sauce, all that lovely stuff. That's when we traditionally see pets come in for issues like pancreatitis, gastritis, and various other reasons. So if you want to continually fund your veterinarian, go ahead and feed it, but I don't personally recommend it.
Well, that's good news. So when we're getting healthy, we want to make sure our animals are getting healthy.
Correct.
Right?
Exactly.
Okay. And there's another question, and then we'll move on real quick. But this fascinates me. I have been learning so much from the two of you in the past week and a half. I'm going, holy Toledo, you don't even think about it, you know? Now, when, and this is for you, Dr. Ken, because you do the surgeries on the, and what you did to Mr. Kitty not too long ago. He came out fine. He was happy. He, you know, enjoyed himself and came home and slept just like you said he would. Mm-hmm. You know? Now, when you bring in, let's say, the orangutan, okay. All right? Because we talked about cats and dogs and everything. The orangutan come in, and they needed a surgery on their stomach because they ate the wrong thing or they swallowed the wrong thing, whatever it is, right? And then, Carmen, you were saying a little bit about it earlier. When the mommy and daddy brings in the animal and they can sit in the room with them, and then when they go to x-rays, mom and dad have to leave,
correct.
Right? And then you go over the results with them, and then it's up to mom and dad what they're going to be doing, right? And then from there, you do the surgery,
right?
Right? Okay, and then I asked you the question, what happens if you have to give CPR? Because I didn't know this until 10 minutes before we got on air. Let's tell everybody this. I mean, it's a fascinating thing.
Well, and if you have an animal in a critical situation, which we hope in surgeries and things like that, we hope we never get to that point. So, you know, on first presentation, we always start with our physical exam and our histories, and we try and get all the basic facts that we need at that particular point. And, history in a diagnosis is probably 50% of what's going on there at that point. So if a client comes in and doesn't have much of a history, I mean, we can't ask the patient what you've eaten or what you've done at that particular point. So we have to also have some intuition at that point. And, so history is very important. And then, we generally will come up with a game plan, a treatment plan, tell mom and dad, here's what's going on. Here's my current interpretation. Here's the testing that I recommend that we do at this time. And, it may be x-rays. It may be lab work. Of course, you have to correlate your physical exam findings with the history. Very, very important. When we go to surgery, I like all of my patients to have IV catheters, IV fluids, just because when you do anesthesia, you do get very, very concerned about keeping blood pressures up. And if you needed resuscitatory drugs, you've got a direct IV access at that time. And, if we were monitoring, which we put pulse oximeters on pets, and we start to see our numbers start to drop, we, of course, have early monitors where we can watch those things and make sure that we're not getting into any problems. If something came down to CPR, of course, if they're under anesthesia, they already have an endotracheal tube in and they're hooked up to oxygen. That's step number one as far as making sure that patients are well oxygenated, well ventilated. CPR itself, I haven't had to do that in a long, long time, but it depends upon the size of the pet and, larger dogs, you have a slower rate where you're putting pressure on the heart and the chest area, just like they would a person with CPR. Mm-hmm. Smaller animals, not as much pressure, more rapid heart rate, trying to assimilate, the normal breathing pattern of and heartbeat of a pet would be. And then, of course, you have a person that's intubating or working the oxygen bag and giving the pet breaths during the CPR. So, but we hope we never get to that point.
That's amazing. Mm-hmm. That's amazing. And the other thing, you take all kinds of animals.
We do.
And that's pretty cool when you think about it.
Yeah.
So, yes, if somebody out there has an orangutan and you got a boo-boo or an elephant, you know where to take them. To Cala Mesa Veterinary Clinic on Cala Mesa Boulevard in Cala Mesa, right? And it's so simple to get to this place, right?
Yep.
And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Let's Go Shopping with Bev right here on KCAA 1050 AM, the station that leaves no listener behind. And we are talking to Carmen and Dr. Ken from the Cala Mesa Veterinarian Clinic. Now, the other thing I wanted to ask you, and you're going to be coming back here, so don't worry about it, okay? With the size of the animal and what kind of animal it is, pretty much, is everything the same, or is there something different that you have to do to certain animals?
Well, different animals have different, you know, internal systems, and the medications that you would use on one pet may not necessarily be applicable for another pet. Examples would be pain medications. Pain relief has been very, very advanced in dogs, and they have lots and lots of different options. Kitty cats, not so much. And, you know, that's an area that, you know, as a veterinarian, you know, we have to know a lot of things about a lot of different species. And, you know, your human MD, I mean, they're basically a specialized veterinarian. They work on one species, and of course they have more toys than we do due to things like insurance companies and, you know, progress in general. But, you know, they work on one species, we work on 15, and I have worked on many, many different things throughout my career. Probably the oddest one I ever worked on was a polar bear that we actually got involved in doing an autopsy on.
Really?
From Brookfield Zoo back when I was in veterinary school back in 1985. And the bear had fallen into a moat and was paralyzed, so the pet ended up being euthanized and they wanted an autopsy performed. And so it was kind of an interesting experience being involved, you know, with doing an autopsy on a polar bear. And it was also interesting that, you know, being a federally protected species, you know, they actually had people at the doors of the exam rooms watching the whole process at this point. And they were making sure, believe it or not, that parts weren't going out the door at that point because it's illegal.
Oh, wow. Yeah, and that's sad. How mm-hmm. many animals
right.
are killed?
Yes.
Just look at the elephants.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of my favorite pets. I'm sorry. Yeah.
I love the elephants, too. I think they're cool.
Yeah, they really are.
Yeah.
And when you think about it, how many animals go through this? And mm-hmm. it's so sad.
Right.
You know?
Exactly.
Yes. And then now, Carmen, to get back to you, when you were saying in the morning when you get there, and you talk to the animals. I love that song. I'm going to be singing that song all day long. I'll get you a copy of the song.
And it was very appropriate.
Wasn't it? And when you do this, now, I know this is going to sound silly, but I got to ask, okay? I know you cannot get attached, right? Even like regular doctors and nurses on human beings, and they start getting attached to a patient, you got to cut that off. But when you go and you see them, and you get smiling, and you say good morning, and all of this. What happens when you do start getting that attachment there? If, you know, the orangutan has to stay for 4 days, let's say, what do you do?
Well, actually, I think all of the employees do get very attached to the uh-huh. pets. It's extremely emotionally difficult for us to sometimes have to. Say it's time to say goodbye. Employees are crying. They're mm-hmm. sad because they've been treating and caring for a pet for many years. Or even just the sadness of maybe, you know, an attack and just really they put their heart and soul into getting this pet back into a good recovery state. Mm-hmm. And they're all very rewarded and happy, the doctors, the staff, when they see the pet is recovering and doing well and coming back. And then, of course, you know, sometimes some pets that are extremely ill and are receiving treatment, that also becomes very emotional. It's a humbling and heartwarming experience all at once. And they're all very passionate about what they do. And that's what makes it easy for me on the stand, that I know that these pets that are coming in are getting this wonderful care by the technicians and the veterinarians. They're very committed in getting this pet healthy. And when I do go back there and get to say hello to them, they do start to get familiar with you. They mm-hmm. feel like, I know you.
Yeah, I recognize that hairdo.
I know you.
Or the sound of your voice, or the smell of your cologne, yeah. or your perfume.
Yeah,
you know?
Sure. Some of the pets, when they come in, you know, this is actually kind of fun.
as well. Sometimes I'll just sit in the lobby because I just want to experience what our people are experiencing. And some pets come in and they're very nervous. They don't want to come in, you know, maybe because they've had shots before or they had blood work and they didn't really like it much. And then some are so excited they just can't hold still. They're just so happy to be there. So I enjoy watching that. I think it was the other day there was this Rottweiler. And he was so gorgeous, just this big, huge Rottweiler, but he looked like he ate a deer on the way in. It was so big.
No, that was a child.
Did they put ketchup on him?
Yeah, his name was Nico, and he put his paws on his, when he came in, he put his paws on his owner's shoulders, and I thought that was so adorable. Like, really, do I have to come in here today? It was cute. So we do get personally attached.
That's amazing. And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Let's Go Shopping with Bev right here on KCAA 1050 AM, the station that leaves no listener behind. And also, we're on 106.5 FM, 102.3 FM, and NBC News. Remember when they used to do that ding-dong on NBC? Mm-hmm. I'm going to get that back. I miss hearing that. You know. And then the other thing I'd like to ask you all, now since we're getting into spring and summer, because we're just a couple of heartbeats away from spring, and it's coming right around the corner. And all of us humans are getting ready, mentally, physically, new haircuts, makeup, spas, whatever. Now, what should one do with their pets right now to get them ready for spring and summer?
Okay, good question. You know, summertime, we like to spend a lot of time outdoors with our pets, and sometimes we travel with our pets, and, you know, we have a lot of different things, and sometimes people even take trips with their pets, and, you know, so some of the things, you know, that with summer in particular that we need to keep in mind, you know, one, some of it's common sense, and then there are some other things that we also need to just kind of think about, too. You know, good example of common sense things is you wouldn't want to leave your pet in a hot car with the windows rolled up. Every year, I mean, we have children that are left in cars, and, you know, you hear about deaths on, you know, the TVs and that type of thing. Well, pets, you know, the same thing applies at that particular point. And, you know, if you figure you've got a pet locked in a car with the windows rolled up 70 degrees, well, within 15 minutes, it'll be up to 110 in that car. And you can't really stand those temperatures very long. So, you know, it's one of those deals that, you know, we have to keep cognizant of that. There's also recently a rule that I saw passed over in Beaumont, you know, meaning a Good Samaritan rule that kind of addresses this particular subject at that particular point. And it was kind of an interesting read in view of the fact that, you know, if you see a pet locked in a car and you're concerned, I mean, obviously you try and contact an owner first. Second thing, of course, is if an owner can't be contacted, you get a hold of the police. You can't get a hold of anything, you know, it now is legal to actually knock in a window to rescue a pet at that particular point.
And I am so happy when they said to do that.
Yes, exactly.
The same way with a child.
Yeah.
You know, and I cannot understand or comprehend in my brain why would somebody leave their child or children in their pets in a car with all the windows open. I mean, close. I can't figure that one out.
No, I don't get it either as far as that kind of thing goes. It's, you know, would you leave your child in the car? Would you leave yourself in the car? You know, I mean, it's common sense.
Yes. And then with that in mind, then also, like you said, with all the traveling, and people do bring their pets, maybe, 80%, 75% would bring their pets along, right?
Yep.
Now, doing that, and you think they should go and get the checkup first.
That's a good idea.
Right?
Right.
Make sure everything is done. If they need a good haircut, you know, slim them down, get that haircut, right?
Exactly.
Now, this is going to sound silly.
No silly questions.
Thank you. I say so many silly things that, you know, it's my nature. Now, when you're traveling cross-country and how a lot of us will put sunglasses on, now they do have the sunglasses for the animals, correct?
I have seen them, yes.
So that would be a good thing to protect their eyes, right?
Potentially. Yeah, I mean, it depends upon the dog. I mean, you get some of these dogs that have hair over their eyes. I mean, they've got natural built-in protections, and dogs are smart enough not to be out looking into direct sunlight and that type of thing. And they have some built-in natural protective mechanisms, such as third eyelids, that would protect them somewhat from sunlight. So I don't think the sunglasses are necessarily a big or that much of a problem. I mean, some of the other things I would say in traveling, make sure your pet's microchipped, that type of thing.
Yes, because that's a biggie.
If a pet gets out of a car at that particular time and happens to run away, and I've yet to see a person be able to outrun a dog and catch a dog at that point, and at least they've got some form of identification on them that they can't lose. In addition to that, having collars and tags on and identification is very, very important. So I think that's kind of important. You want to make sure you keep your pets on leash. It's also a good idea if you're traveling with a pet in a car, if it's a small enough pet, to either have them in a carrier or in a pet-type harness in the car at this point. And I can tell you a personal experience of this. I was driving from Arizona to Illinois during the middle of a move, and we had we were coming out of a toll booth, and officer pulled me over for some reason, which still to this day don't quite understand it, but I had a boxer in the front seat with me, and we had her harnessed in. Well, Mr. Officer Friendly came out and said, "Well, can you step out to the back and come over to my car?" And turned out, he pulled me over because I had a license plate frame on that partially obscured part of the car, so the plate, I didn't get a ticket or anything, but it was just like, really, But if I had not had my dog harnessed in there and she escaped out on the freeway, I mean, that could have been a very dangerous situation at that point, and not only dangerous for the dog, but dangerous for people driving and just in general. I mean, it's prevented the animal from getting out and about. And also, one time when I was first moved to California, which I'm originally from Illinois, I was actually pulling a trailer and got caught in a crosswind, and it actually flipped the trailer and, ended up crashing the car. Well, I had a dachshund that was riding in the seat next to me, and, the dog went out of the car and was running down the freeway at that point.
Whoa.
Fortunately, nobody really got hurt, but if I had not had the dog, if I would have had the dog in a carrier, the dog would not have been out running down the freeway at that particular point. So keeping things like small animals in contained areas versus being free in vehicles, they're not going to get under your brake pedal. They're not going to get underneath your gas pedal at that point. It's more of a safety reason that we also consider for something like that. And also in traveling, we do recommend getting exams before you go, checking and seeing what you would need for local travels and things like that. Sometimes they require health certificates to go across certain state lines. Sometimes they don't. We always do recommend to carry rabies certificate. We do, just in case the pet were to bite or scratch somebody. In addition to that, I also do recommend that clients carry a copy of their pet's health records with them, just because if something were to happen to the pet while you were on your trip, you've got the background and your veterinarian that you would be going to for your medical care would have some idea as to what the pet's past history is, and might be able to make some decisions on the basis of that. And of course, at Cala Mesa, we're always available for other veterinarians to call for information too, but actually having that record in your hand is really, really a good idea.
So basically, what we would do, being two-legged animals, right, then we do it for our four-legged animals.
Exactly.
Pretty much.
Right.
Right? Okay, can you guys stay a little bit longer?
Absolutely.
Okay, right now we're going to go to break, and we'll be right back.
San Bernardino, Loma Linda, Rialto listens to KCAA Radio.
Hi, this is Cliff from Cliff's Pest Control. Have you had problems with pests lately? Cliff's Pest Control has been in business for over 40 years and is family owned and operated. We can take care of your general pest problems, that's the ants, spiders, all the crawling bugs, and we also can take care of your termite problems. You can reach us at 909-887-1862, that's 909-887-1862. That's Cliff's Pest Control, Inc., serving the Inland Empire for over 40 years.
Hi, my name is Don, and I work with my wife, Marie. We are holistic health practitioners specializing in magnetic therapy. Got pain? Get relief. We are the got pain people. The benefits of magnetic therapy are speed up healing time, reduce discomfort and pain, reduce inflammation, detoxify your body, help improve blood flow. Got pain? Get relief. We are the got pain people. With MD Jarbaugh Magnetics, we can be reached at 951-743-6903. We help to relieve pain without the dangerous side effects of drugs. Some of the other benefits of biomagnetism are a safe alternative for the treatment of over 500 ailments, including cancers, chronic back pain, migraines, asthmas, cysts, tumors, acne, arthritis, knee pain, sports injuries, broken bones, high blood pressure, diabetes, fibromyalgia, sciatica, multiple sclerosis, stroke recovery. It also helps reconnect the brain to the nerves. We are located in Yucaipa, and we are the Got Pain People. With MD Jarbaugh Magnetics, got pain, get relief. 951-743-6903. Once again, 951-743-6903.
Hi, this is Todd from the Flip Flop Investor Show. Join us every Thursday at 4 p.m. where we talk about real estate investments here in the Inland Empire. Before you go to a real estate seminar, come check out our Real Estate Investment Club that meets at the Mission Inn in Riverside every fourth Wednesday. Find out more on our weekly show at 4 p.m. Thursdays right here on KCAA 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM.
KCAA Radio, Loma Linda, where no listener is ever left behind.
And we're back. And Brandon just told me our second guest is on the line for us. And Brandon, who is on the line, please?
We have Sarah from Guide Dogs of the Desert.
Hi, Sarah. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Bev. Great to be here. Thank you.
You're welcome. And I'm glad we had this opportunity. And you're probably listening on your end of the program. And we have Carmen and Dr. Ken from the Cala Mesa Veterinarian Clinic. And it's amazing how close both of you are with the animals. And Sarah, could you tell us the beginning of your story, please? When did it get started and why?
Guide Dogs of the Desert was founded in 1971 here in the desert area by a gentleman who was a guide dog trainer and had wanted to make sure that everybody that was deserving of a guide dog got one. And the reason that was so important is back in those days, if you will, that's 45 years ago, a lot of the schools didn't dual train dogs for guide service, and then if the person had another disability or something that maybe their physical condition caused them to be a little bit slower in the speed of learning things, and they wouldn't be accepted at a guide dog school. So he started his own school down here in the desert, along with the help of the Cathedral City Lions Club and other community members.
That's amazing. Absolutely amazing. And when I was talking to you this morning, I have to say the same thing to you that I said to Carmen and Dr. Ken. I have learned so much from the three of you in the past 48 hours that I didn't even think about. So thank you for that.
Well, you're welcome.
And now with the guard dogs, and you see, unfortunately, a lot of people that are blind that lost their sight from a disease, or an accident, whatever. Now, this part really amazes me. Could you tell all of our listeners how you breed the dogs and how you get the dogs to the right person?
Absolutely. Well, we monitor our breeding stock very carefully, and we do breed our own dogs, and they are bred with service in mind. So we choose Labrador Retrievers, Golden Retrievers, German Shepherds, and Standard Poodles. And they are closely, as I said, closely monitored. They, our director of the breeding program actually goes back about eight generations of dogs and then follows that all the way forward, looking for the highest quality traits for a guide service dog. And they're all registered with the AKC. Mm-hmm. And these are really the dogs that have the right stuff. So attentiveness, of course, their own vision, the hearing, being able to train to what we call intelligent disobedience. And that plays a major role when someone, the person that is blind would give the dog a command. And if the dog knows that command isn't safe, like, you know, go forward and step off of a curb.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if a car is turning around the corner, the dog's going to ignore that command. And the person gives the command again. Of course, they don't see the car, but the dog hears the car, sees the car, and says, we're not stepping off this curb. It's not safe. That's uh-huh. called intelligent disobedience.
Yes. Don't you wish some people had that?
Yes.
You know? And then I love the way that the story goes. You know, we're going to need a three-hour show. You know, that's what we all need, a three-hour show. And then the other thing that I found very interesting is when somebody gets that young adult, they have to be 18 or older.
That is correct.
And then they fill, well, someone helps them fill out the application with what kind of eye disease they have. Do they have other diseases, like maybe an artificial leg or something with the hip or this or that? They have to fill this all out. Then if they're accepted, then you know exactly what kind of dog to put with that person.
We do, and we take a lot of things into account. So what is the person's lifestyle? Do they still have a full-time job? Do they live rurally? Do they live within the suburbs? Do they live in a downtown apartment building mm-hmm. in a metropolitan area? What is their daily schedule like? They need to be able to be active. And by that is walk a half an hour to 1 hour routes a couple of times a day.
That's so very good.
This isn't somebody that is homebound, that's going to sit and watch TV all day. This is somebody that's out and about.
Mm-hmm.
We have a gentleman in the Beaumont area that lives in a retired community, and he's in his early 90s, but he still goes out and walks 4 miles every day within his gated community with his guide dog.
That's amazing.
That's so, but he's able to do that because he has the dog.
Uh-huh.
And that's the kind of activity that we're looking for. And the, you know, when you consider, okay, there's a guide dog and they're guiding the person, but the person also has to have leadership skills
mm-hmm.
because they're considered the alpha of the relationship, and they have to be able to give the commands. And they still have to be consistent in the obedience of the dog, the behavior of the dog, and everything. So it's not like you just get this guide dog and off you go. It's definitely a working relationship between the person and their matched dog.
And then also you were telling me how they join. It's like they're on the first date. Let's put it, they're on the first date and they meet, and then they're doing the courting thing before they get married, right? Or
right.
decide to live together.
Right.
And we said it that way for it's simpler for some people to understand. They come down to your location, and they spend 30 days at your location free of charge, which is just blew my mind away. And the dogs are free. Also,
everything that we provide is free to the client.
That's, you know, how many people can do this? You know what I'm saying? And so what they do is once you say, let's say Joe Baloney's coming down,
mm-hmm.
okay? And he is 6 feet, 2 inches tall, and
okay.
he's very slender. Well, you're not going to put a smaller dog with him. You're going to use, and that's where the poodles come in because of the different heights. To protect them as they're walking and maneuvering and all of this. But they have this chance to be together with the teachers and the instructors and instructors so they can bond.
Mm-hmm. They can bond
yeah,
and
it's
that
so
they
cool.
can learn, well, and that they learn the command
mm-hmm.
and the trust builds between the dog and the person. There's, you know, there's a lot of training that goes into it, and that's why they're here on the campus for 4 weeks. the first day that they are issued their dog is predominantly a day where they just spend it together, getting to know each other and everything. And then the training begins in earnest, and that covers all aspects of daily living. So, you know, we have a shuttle bus. They go to downtown Palm Springs area and on the quieter streets, and they walk that. They learn about, you know, approaching a curb. A dog stops at the curb. Mm-hmm. The person can feel with their foot that, oh, okay, here's a step down, and they step down and proceed forward. Now, if a car's coming, the dog will not move forward. And that's the traffic training. Uh-huh. They also go through training at the airport. A lot of people travel, and, of course, guide dogs are service dogs. And so there is training going through maneuvering all the way through an airport or through a bus station. They ride the Metrolink to downtown Los Angeles. There's all different modes of transportation that they're trained with. There's, going to a restaurant and how the dog behaves when it goes in a restaurant. The true indication is, and I know that you're probably aware, there's a lot of people that try to pass other dogs off as service dogs.
Yes.
That aren't.
Unfortunately, that happens.
A true service dog, you will not even know is around. They basically become invisible.
That is so cool.
Yeah.
That is so cool. And then also, I was talking about how they are getting to know each other. We got to sing that song, Getting to Know You. Da, 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 da. That'd be a cute song for that. And then the other thing, now please tell all of our listeners, what is happening on Saturday, April 1st, down in your neck of the woods?
Well,
this is so exciting, guys. I can't wait.
It is. We currently have a class in that is training with their guide dogs. And on Saturday, April the 1st, at 12 noon, here at the campus in Whitewater, California, is going to be the graduation of those teams that are now training. And it's a wonderful ceremony. And the puppy raisers that have been raising those dogs up until they came back for formal training attend the ceremony as well, and in effect, hand the dog over to the person.
Oh,
and it's very emotional. The clients talk about the difference that the dog now makes in their life in the way of safe mobility and providing independence. We had a gentleman that said that does travel extensively for business. He's actually a research scientist with a pharmaceutical company. And he said, having this guide dog is going to extend my career by years because now I'll be able to travel.
Unbelievable.
So, yeah,
you know, that gives me goosebumpies.
That's sweet.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, you know, we ought to go down. You want to come with me?
I'll go with you.
Okay. Yeah, because you're in the business of animal mammals, yeah. Right?
Yes. And the graduation is free. It's open to the public. We welcome people coming up to the campus and seeing the campus, and definitely seeing the graduation.
And, Sarah, could you pump out all your contact information, please?
Absolutely. So the school, Guide Dogs of the Desert, is located at 60735 Dillon Road in Whitewater, California. Our phone number is 760-329-6257, and you can find us on the internet at www.gddca.org.
One more time.
Okay. The internet is www.g as in guide, d as in dog, d as in dog, ca.org.
That is so cool. That is so cool. And now, can you come back on with us one of these days pretty soon?
Oh, I'd be happy to come back on and talk more with you, Bev.
Yes. And, Sarah, what is the one big thing you want everybody to know?
The one big thing that I really want everybody to know is that everything that we provide to our clients is provided at no cost. And the way that we're able to do that is through private philanthropy. Mm-hmm. So we are a nonprofit, and every gift is important to helping us place these custom-trained guide dogs with the blind and visually impaired. We don't get any support from any level of government. It is all through private philanthropy, service organizations, and foundations.
That is fantastic. Yes, it is. Now, hang on with us for a minute. Don't hang up right away, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Now, Carmen, Dr. Kent, bump out your contact information.
Yeah, actually, I did want to say we have Dr. Ken McMillan with us today. He's the other doctor there at the...
I just call him Dr. Ken. I think that's kind of cool.
And that's perfect because they call me Dr. Mac at the hospital.
Oh, okay.
Yep. And we are located at 980 Cala Mesa Boulevard in Cala Mesa. The phone number is 909-795-0030. And that's Cala Mesa Veterinary Clinic.
One more time.
At 980 Cala Mesa Boulevard, Cala Mesa, 909-795-0030.
And Carmen, with you and Dr. Ken, what is the one big thing you want everybody to know?
Well, I think, you know, the biggest thing we would want out there is that we're trying to be the best doctors we can, and we greatly, greatly care about our patients, and we care about our clients, and that, you know, our clients' pets are our extended family. So we treat the pets as they would be our own pets at this point. And, you know, we develop a huge level of attachment, and, you know, that's just how we are at this point. We do what we do because we love our jobs, and with me, it's a lifelong passion, and, you know, I can still say after 32 years of practice that I love my job. And there aren't a lot of people that can say that.
Right, very few and far in between. Mm-hmm. And Sarah, now hearing all of this, the one thing I forgot to ask you to mention, you have four different kinds of dogs.
That's correct.
Would you like to tell us about that, please?
Absolutely. So we breed Labrador Retrievers, Golden Retrievers, German Shepherds, and standard poodles. We're only one of, there's only two schools in the country that actually breed and train the standard poodle. And those dogs are phenomenally intelligent. They're really good for people that have dog allergies or a family member that has a dog allergy. And we actually had a lady, one of our clients who worked in the food industry. Her first guide dog was a German Shepherd, but the German Shepherd couldn't go with her to work because of the shedding.
Ah.
And standard poodles don't have fur, they have hair.
Uh-huh.
They're so hypoallergenic. And then the other thing is they have a different skeletal structure from the other dogs. So they're lighter. And as, again, one of our clients mentioned, it's an easier drive, if you will. The guide dog, in essence, does pull a little bit when a person is walking with them. And when you consider a muscular dog like a Labrador Retriever or a German Shepherd, that's a pretty strong pull mm-hmm. on that handle. And the standard poodle's pull is a lot lighter and more gentle. So if there's someone that has the back injury or they're older, and you mentioned the height,
mm-hmm.
All of that comes into play with placing a standard poodle with someone.
I'll tell you, I am learning and learning and learning. And what I would like to see happen, Sarah, between you and Lynn and everybody in your organization, meet Carmen and Dr. Ken and their team. And I could just picture everybody, you know, having a bigger picnic lunch or something, you know, getting to know each other and getting to really know all the animals. I think that would be absolutely fabulous.
Sure.
Sure, that would be
absolutely
fun.
Let's do that, huh?
Sure.
And tomorrow morning, all this information is going to be on Facebook and Twitter.
Okay.
Yes. And tomorrow I'll be seeing the Women's Club. We have another meeting. I'm going to bump all this information out to all of them ladies also.
Okay.
You know?
Great. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Awesome. So, and I just got the two fingers. That means we got 2 minutes left. And Sarah, one other thing that I wanted to ask you. There must be one story, one person, and one dog that sticks in your mind after all these years. Do you have a short story to tell us?
I have a real short story. We had a client last spring, a young woman who's actually going to University of Nevada at Las Vegas. She'd been blind since birth. And the first day she got her dog and they were out walking, she's made the comment, "This is the first time I feel like I'm now walking normally."
Whoa.
She had a cane, you know, and she was very proficient with her white cane. But to be able to walk at a quicker pace, and as she said, "I feel like I'm walking normal."
I love that
story. She felt like
story.
She was flying. Yeah.
That is so cool. And Brandon just gave me the one finger. That means 1 minute, guys. Okay, that's what that means. Okay, guys, bump out. One quick story that you have. Do you have anything? They're pointing at each other here, like.
Well, I was wanting him to introduce, and we didn't go over his credentials, and I was hoping he could say that.
Okay, bump it on out.
I'm originally from Illinois, and I'm a 1985 graduate of the University of Illinois. I live in Beaumont, and with my wife Barb, so no Barbie and Ken jokes. And I have three Boston Terriers and a Yorkie Chihuahua mix, and we have two Pacific Parrotlets. So that's my family.
That is so cool. And guys, thank you for tuning in. Have a lovely rest of the day. Tomorrow morning, all of this will be on Facebook and Twitter. Sarah, thank you so much for calling in. I'll talk to you soon. Dr. Ken, Carmen, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Dr.
Thank
Bombay,
you.
You're welcome. Dr. Bombay, the Blue Machine Band's dancing us out. Ciao.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM.
Good afternoon. I'm Chuck Kamlick, CNBC. A mixed end to the day on Wall Street. The Dow dropped 6, but the Nasdaq was up 27, the S&P 4. Investors are waiting for tomorrow's healthcare vote.